In this video, I want to show you a little bit about the Virtualmin command line, or the CLI, or the command line API. This is a set of commands, there's subcommands underneath the Virtualmin command, that allow the root user to manage pretty much every aspect of a Virtualmin server, from creating and managing domains, mailboxes, databases. Pretty much all of your configuration and stuff can be modified and changed, and you can do most of the actions you would do from the GUI from the command line. And so this is super convenient for if you're scripting, if you're calling Virtualmin from Puppet or Chef or SaltStack or any of those things, if you've written your own custom whatever deployment system or billing system or whatever, or if you're integrating with the billing system, you can use either the CLI or its sort of mirror image, the remote API, which uses all the same commands. It just gets to them via a web request rather than from the command line. Okay, so documentation for the command line API, you can find that on virtualmin.com. You just click on documentation and browse down to the developer section, and you'll find the command line API thing. It's this URL up here. And Virtualmin has a ton of subcommands. And when I say Virtualmin in this context, I mean the Virtualmin command that you call, you know, that you run from the command line. And it covers all the various categories of things, includes some of the plugins. Like I say, most of the things that you can do from the GUI, you can also do from the command line. And I'll show you a couple of examples of that. And we'll poke around on our demo server and do some things. So in the documentation, I'll kind of point out that, like I say, it's categorized. It's in categories based on sort of the sorts of activity you're wanting to do. So virtual servers covers all the domain-related activities like creating, cloning, deleting, modifying various features within the domain and that kind of thing. There are also categories for users, mail and FTP users, aliases, owner limits, so modifying, you know, how much stuff, you know, how many domains they can create, how many databases, various sizes, that kind of thing. Backup and restore is really convenient to have on the command line. A lot of folks want to automate that with scripts, and so that may be a useful thing. Obviously, you can also schedule backups within Virtualmin in the GUI. You never have to hit the command line, just if you want to call it from a cron job or something. But if you already have an automated, some kind of automated backup system, and you want to add this as just an additional command, you can do that there. So lots of things. I encourage you to browse around, look at the documentation. There is also online help. And I'm going to go ahead and log in to our server. Let's see, there we go. I'm going to go ahead and log into the server that we've been working on. And I'll just show you that it does have built-in online help. And there's, obviously, it's pretty intimidating, but you just kind of work your way through it and think about what you're wanting to do, and you can grep through that and find what you're looking for, or you can browse it on the web or whatever. But then there's also additional help. So if we wanted to create a new domain, for instance, we could get help by just, you know, grabbing that. I know there's also Perl doc. There's also a man page for this somewhere. There we go. So you can type help and then the name of the command, and it'll open up the man page for that. Okay, so self-documenting. If you know the secret incantation, I'm sure that's actually documented somewhere. But anyway, so you can get help for the various commands that you're wanting to use. And so I just want to show you sort of a, you know, a common use case. Creating a domain is probably the most common use case. And we can look up here and we can see all the options that we have for that. And there are required options. We need a domain and we either need a password or a pass file. And a pass file is just a way to pass in a password without it, being exposed on the command line, or in the environment or anything like that. Maybe useful for scripting. And then all the rest of these are optional, although you do have to enable features for the domain somehow. And I'm just going to choose to use the default features, which is this option right here. And usually I do recommend that you get your server templates and your account plans in a way that are set up in a way that you don't need to poke at the various features, either in the UI or in command line. It's easy to change them when you're creating, but it's really useful to have a setup that you know and understand and know all the features that are going to be enabled and all the privileges that you're going to be granting to your users. So it's useful to go through the server templates and kind of figure out what you want your domains to look like and then configure your system to do that by default. And then you can change it if you need to for specific use cases. So I'm just going to create a new CLI demo.vmin.pw. That's the zone we're working with. And I'm going to give it a password, just a dumb password here. And I can put that in quotes if I need it to contain spaces or anything. And remember that when we're dealing with the command line, the shell will do some expansions and stuff on its own. So sometimes if you use special characters, they might do something weird. And so since you don't want that to happen, you got to remember to escape your special characters by putting a backslash in front of them. But I'm not going to use any special characters here. I just want to give you a heads up that if you're putting special characters in there, get familiar with your shell and what special characters will have weird behavior. Because if I were to put, say, a dollar sign in there, that would actually expand this, probably, out to whatever was in that, which would be nothing. So my password would end up being 12345 instead of 12345 dude. And that's not what we want. We want a good long password with goofy words in them. Okay, so, and I'm going to, as I said, I'm just going to choose the default features thing, and that will just set it up to use the default account plan and the default server template. We could also tell it to use a different template name. We would still need to tell it default features, and that would use the default features from that template name. That's a little tricky. I probably had to talk to Jamie about the way that plays out. Anyway, so this is pretty much all we need. Just like on the domain creation form in the previous video, where we really didn't need to fill in anything, we just gave it a name and we gave it a password, and then we clicked, create, and away it went. Same deal here. I'm going to hit enter, and this is going to do the exact same thing it would do in the GUI. And in fact, it's using the same code, and we see this looks exactly the same as what shows up in the little output of Virtualmin. And so now we can list our servers, and we can see that we now have this extra server. And it obviously will show up in the user interface. Let's see if it's already there. Nope. Forgive my slow internet connection. I use a mobile connection, so it's very, very slow sometimes. All right, and so now we have three domains here, and the same ones that we saw on the command line. And you'll notice this is kind of a user-friendly, human-readable sort of thing, but if you were scripting, you'd want to use some other kind of output. And we have a few different kinds of output. And so we have multi-line, and we have simple multi-line, and I'll show you the simple multi-line. Either of these are suitable for scripting, depending on what kind of scripting language you're using. But so, as you can see, we have sections that list out all these things. And then there's all of the variables that are related to that. And so you could grab that into, a variable and parse that out. There are other ways to do this in different languages and that kind of thing. But I don't want to go into too much depth. But I just wanted to show you that you have a lot of flexibility in what you can do with this. So let's list one specific domain. And then let's get the get some more output out of that. There we go. And so now we can see just this one server, all the information about it. Most commands have a domain option so that you can specify which domain. In the case of the user-related commands, there will be a user command that you can use to get all the information about a specific domain. And I want to show you enabling a feature. And I think this server does not have SSL enabled. Yeah, so we have web, but we don't have HTTPS. Okay, so I want to show you another command. We can enable features within a domain, and there's an enable feature command for that. And so since I don't have SSL enabled, I'll go ahead and do that for this domain. Okay, so now we have that feature enabled. And if I list that domain again, we should see SSL enabled. And we do. And it tells us what the SSL key file is. Pretty much all the information that we need about this server. Again, if we were scripting this, if we needed to back this up, or I don't know what all we would want to do with this, but yeah, so we can, and there's also the mirror command of disable feature, so we could disable some of this stuff, like if we didn't want Webalizer, or we didn't want to host our own DNS for this, or any of that, we could do that. We can make changes to the database, etc. Yeah, so I don't want to go into too much further detail. Like I said, I'm going to cover the remote API, the remote version of this in another video. I just wanted to put this on your radar. Really, you pretty much have to spelunk in the documentation to define what you're looking for. But I want you to kind of have confidence that it's probably in there. You just need to look around for it, poke around and find it. Because whatever it is you're trying to do with a script, somebody's probably tried to do it before and we've probably already implemented it. And there's a ton of commands, as I mentioned. And so I guess to keep things neat and tidy, I'm going to go ahead and delete that domain that we created. And we'll come full circle and be back to where we were. And notice that unlike in the GUI, the command line interface does not give you warnings. It does not say, oh, do you really want to do that? It trusts that if you've gone to the trouble to type in a command, you really want to do it. So make sure if you're typing in a command, you really want to do it. Especially if it's deleting a domain or doing something like that. All right. Thanks for watching. Like and subscribe if you want to see more videos about Virtualmin. Let me know in the comments if there's anything else you want me to cover. If you think I went too fast or too slow on this topic, just let me know, and I'll try to do better next time.